is a board member of the Maine chapter of the National Football Foundation and College Hall of Fame. He is a youth football coach in Sanford and is part of the SMYFL. He at one point was a candidate for governor in our state, but with the National Football Foundation, he usually hosts our annual kickoff college luncheon. He played football. He was a white mule. Nobody's perfect. He went to Colby and played there as a captain, graduated in 95, but he's now a lawyer in Portland at a pretty big firm. And he's really an advocate for youth sports in general, but especially football. And when Mike started this round table, having heard him talk about his passion for youth sports, and football, I thought he might be a good addition. He had a 5 o'clock Zoom with a veterans group that he helps represent, and then he was going to come on after and join the conversation.
What happened?
Awesome. We'll just go around quick introductions. I'm Mike Hathaway. I'm the head football coach at Levitt High School.
What happened?
Go ahead, Coach Sinclair.
I kind of lost you, but Bob Sinclair, head football coach at Orono. At Orono, technologically challenged. I'll find a way to get back on it.
Yeah, Coach Wolfgram, assistant coach at Chevros High School.
Perk.
Matt Perkins, head coach at Windham High School.
Coop.
I'm Kevin Cooper. I'm the head football coach at Bon Eagle High School.
Danny White.
Danny White, head football coach, Fox Rock Academy.
Jesus.
And Dan O'Connell.
Hi, guys. I'm Dan O'Connell. I am the head football coach at John Babs in Bangor. I'm also your coach's liaison to the MPA, and I'm here today to represent the youth football program in Bangor as a board member. So thanks for having me.
Perfect. I got a lot of questions, so I'll kind of get going right away. The first question up is, as a high school coach, what level of involvement do you have?
Why'd I lose this, Ellie?
Let me mute Bob there for a minute. What level of involvement do you have with your youth program as the high school coach? So, you know, what's your role and how much say do you have in what goes on there? We'll start with start with Coach Wolfgram. When you were at Chevros, that's a little bit of a different animal in terms of the youth program. But in terms of, you know, your South Portland days and prior to that, what was your involvement in the youth program?
Okay, I've actually put together three youth programs, one in Madison back in the early 70s, one in Gardner through 85, and one in South Portland through 2000, basically. So I was pretty much involved. I basically ran some clinics for all the coaches. I helped fit equipment, basically, for the going into the season.
Oh, yeah, I started class down, and I said, I know he's going to call him.
And I tried to go to every Sunday game when we had Sunday games. And so I'm here today mostly advocating for flag football, which I'm a big believer in. I've done a lot of research in that area. That was actually going to be the presentation that I was going to do at the real clinic back at the holiday. So I have put together a youth football program. And I certainly believe in the contact piece, but I think I'm here more than anything else to advocate for flag football.
Awesome. Coach Sinclair, how about you? What's your involvement like with the youth football program at Orono?
Well, I'll back up. Like Coach Wolfgram, I was involved in Hamden, and of course that was a long time ago, but at that time we felt they didn't have a youth program per se, but we started a 3-4-5-6 flag program, and that went pretty well. And then after leaving there, I was at different places. I was an assistant. I went to Huston. I was at Bucksport, and I came home. And our rec department at that time had our youth program, and it was run by John Lucy and some people who were, pretty much Orono stalwarts, been here for a long time. And so it kind of ran itself. And then our rec program fell apart, and the godfather of our program has really been Mark Smith. Mark has done a great job supporting us in many ways with our program. And so we started it privately 4 years ago now, and I've been pretty much involved with it. We sat down with some other gentlemen, him and I, two or three other people in the community. And that's where we're at. But, you know, we're kind of trying to figure out where we are. I sent some emails out to some other coaches who are involved with 8-man to find out what their youth program looks like. And I got some responses back. But we'll have youth football. I'll be involved somehow. I've coached it, practiced, and all kinds of stuff. So that's about it.
Awesome, Coach. Thank you. Perk, how about you?
Yeah, so I'm on the board of directors now with our youth program, and we meet once a month. So create a position. So I help develop coaches coming in, hire, fire, all that process. We had some issues of years back. We just had some people with the wrong agenda and doing what was best for them and their kid and not everybody else. So we really created a lot of things to basically make it so you couldn't, a guy couldn't come in and screw it up. So we have a lot of contracts they have to sign and so on. But it's a monthly thing where we meet and go over who's on board and who we have and assistance and so on.
That's awesome. How about you, Coop?
Yeah, so at Bon Eagle, our football booster club oversees football from the first time a kid starts playing football, whether that's first grade. We have some kindergartners that are part of our K-2 flag league, but our booster club will oversee football for kids that young all the way up to seniors in high school. And so that's a pretty massive undertaking that our group does. I am intimately involved with our football booster club, so therefore definitely involved with our youth football program. I would say more from a administrative position and oversee position, organizational piece. Obviously, I can't be there on the day-to-day aspects of it. But as far as helping to train coaches, helping to develop a program that will suit our needs at Bon Eagle, definitely involved with that stuff. And also, most recently coming from a position as a parent too, as my, my youngest son just finished sixth grade, football last fall. So for the last 5 years, my kids have been in our youth program coming up from our third and fourth grade division through our fifth and sixth grade division. So got to kind of have that aspect as a parent as well. So that's my involvement.
Youth football.
And Danny, how about you? Danny White.
So as I've said before on another Zoom call, we Foxcroft Academy runs youth sports in Dover Foxcroft. So I actually run the flag program at the YMCA, which starts in kindergarten. So kindergarten, first grade, second grade, myself and my assistants at the high school level, along with our student athletes will do the flag football program through the Y. I actually coach the third and fourth grade team in large part because my son's 10 years old. So I do that. And then we hold several meetings throughout the summer for the third, fourth team and the fifth and sixth grade team. And then the seventh and eighth grade coaches are on my high school staff. So, myself and the athletic director at the academy have full say as to who's coaching in the youth program. So that makes it pretty transparent.
Awesome. And then Dan O'Connell, how about you?
Well, I come at this a number of ways. At John Baps, we don't have our own youth program. However, we do have kids who come to our school from all of the surrounding towns. So when youth football in the area is better, it stands to reason that we're going to have more experienced kids, or at least a pool of more experienced kids in the sport of football come to our school. I am currently a board member on the Bangor program, in the Bangor program, for a couple of reasons. First, like Danny, my son's involved. Coop mentioned the same thing. My son just got done with youth football, so for the last couple of years I've been involved because of him. But I'd also like to briefly tell you about what brought me there before Matthew became involved, and it was actually Coach Haley. he had a saying that he used to share with us on the regular, and he used to tell me over and over again, if you don't cultivate what you have coming to you, you only have yourself to blame. And I used to get really frustrated because I didn't have my own program to run and I couldn't control who was coming to me. And after a lot of talks with Coach Haley, it became clear that just because I didn't have my own program doesn't mean I couldn't affect youth football in the area. So one of the reasons I'm here, like so many of you, is to make sure that we take care of youth football in our state. It's not just something we should do. It's something we have to do. Because if we don't, like Coach Haley said, we'll only have ourselves to blame. And we need numbers. And so at this point, whether it's Bangor or Brewer or Hamden or Orono or anywhere in the state, if there's anything I can do to promote youth football and help in any way possible, that's why I'm here.
Awesome. Just, you know, from my perspective, you know, I've been at Leavitt since 2002. You know, when I first got there, the guy who is my line coach, Dave Bachler, he was kind of running the football portion of the youth sports organization we have. We have one for each town that feeds into Leavitt, but in the sports of basketball and football, they kind of work together. We kind of pool the athletes. So at the time, Dave was the head of the football, so it was good to have him, you know, obviously directly in my program and working in that one as well. As the years went on, my own kids started playing, so I probably became a little bit more involved in terms of the coaching and probably in terms of the realization that, you know, some of the coaches who were down there, you know, needed to be worked with and needed to be worked with by me and my staff. So I've spent a lot of time over the last, I don't know, probably 10, 12 years, you know, trying to help those guys out and develop a system where we can kind of progress kids, you know, with the fundamentals and the techniques that they need for when they get to high school. You know, I don't have an official position, like I'm not on any sort of board or anything like that, but we have a youth football director, and then there's usually an assistant director as well, and I work really closely with those two guys. We'd have a lot of say over who's coaching what teams and stuff like that. And then our middle school program is run by the school. You know, we had a coaching change a few years ago in that, probably goes back 4 or 5 years ago now. And we kind of moved some guys out of there who needed to be moved out of there. And, some of the guys from my staff, decided to take it over. My father and if you guys know Alan Peabody, who played for us this year, just graduated, his dad, there's a guy named Dave Coburn who lives locally here. And those three kind of took it on and have been doing that. So mostly I'm just trying to assist those guys as much as I can. I wouldn't say I have any official say, but I would also say that they probably don't do much without contacting me first. So it's kind of where that stands. Two things that came up as guys were going around that I want to mention right off the bat, and I'll go to Coach Wolfgram to start. You mentioned flag football. You know, just kind of let's go around at least to a couple guys and talk about what you think about flag football. You know, maybe in terms of, and I know we all differ in opinion a little bit, but in terms of, you know, when kids should start to tackle, what flag football should look like, you know, and some of the key components there. So Coach Wolfgram, you got some thoughts on that. Why don't you go ahead?
Yeah, I'll start with that. To begin with, first of all, Mike, I think we have to think outside the box of what we're doing. We know it's well documented the numbers in football are going down. Flag football's numbers have increased last year 17%. It's the only part of football where we had an increase. What we've got to do is we've got to create multi-entrance points for kids going into football. Even if they want to wait to the eighth grade, after the eighth grade, I see no problem with that whatsoever. We've got to have kids involved in a safe atmosphere that they're going to play and have fun, and parents are going to allow them to play. Big thing is, of course, the mothers. And, you know, I think I understand the value of contact football. I've been doing it for 49 years. I understand that very well. But I think today there is an increased emphasis on safety. with a concussion situation, with understanding that young kids, pre-pubescent kids, have a weakness in the neck and shoulders. Also, a lot of kids, young kids like that, don't have the mental, emotional makeup to learn how to tackle. And to me, the big thing is tackling. That's the big thing. So I guess to start us off, I think we should wait as long as possible before we get kids into contact football. I'm going to recommend a paper that was written 2 years ago by the Aspen Institute of Sport. They wrote a paper on flag football, a white paper. It was quite long, but it was very, very good. It's well researched. It had a lot of credible people involved. And their recommendation 2 years ago that we wait all the way to high school before kids play contact football. Now, I'm not going that far, but I think the longer we wait, the better for safety purposes, for parental purposes, and also I think flag football is fun for the kids. I think it's a lot of fun. So I'll start off with those ideas.
Coach Sinclair, how about you?
Let me try that again. Coach Sinclair, how about you?
Gotcha. I was interested in what Coach Wolfgram said about where we're going and thinking outside the box. We have a flag football program. It is one of the few things that the rec department Orono hung on to. Our 5-6 is tackle. Our program is a little bit different. We recruit kids from surrounding towns. The flag program is the only part of our program that's not impacted by reaching out to other communities to try to get them involved with our program at any level, whether it's the youth level or the middle school level or the high school level. And our community's changed a lot. I think anybody who's lived in Orono for a long time, I've lived here all my life, community's just different. I won't get into it and bore everybody with the details of what's going on in Orono, but taxes are high. People have moved out. The community, the demographics of this town have changed a lot since Coach Wolfgram played at the University of Maine. And that has an impact on how many kids we have and then what kind of kids we do have. I think, cultivating flag football at the lower levels, at any level, is really, really important. The mother factor, I don't think in our community you can discredit that one much. Although at the high school level, we got some mothers who love football, so we'll take them. We love them. But that's my 2 cents worth. Big on flag football.
Perk?
Yeah, 2 years ago when I was in Orlando for that conference, USA Football Conference, there was some really good information, and Coach Wolfgram hit on some of that with numbers. And there's been a big study in Iowa how so many people were against it, and that's really kind of changed and cultivated kids being confident in playing the game. And Coach just hit on it with the moms being concerned with concussions, and it's really changed. And we're trying to prepare in Wyndham for that. We actually let kids choose in second and third grade what they want to do, but we are tackle 4-5 up, but we're preparing to go to the modified flag next few years. So it's something we've been prepping for, been in talks with USA Football about how to get that started, what that looks like, and so on. So yeah, whatever gets kids involved, we're all in.
Coop?
Yes, so the other night I made mention, we started talking about this in the head coaches roundtable, that after watching my sons the last 5 years come up through our youth program, tackle football was fine for them. They were ready for it. They didn't mind the contact. But that's not the case for everybody. And so what I would like to see and what we're pushing for at Bon Eagle is to develop a flag component that will hopefully attract more kids out to play. I know most of our people that are involved with football are very hesitant to give up our tackle program, which we started in the third grade. Which I understand. I think if you ask my own two kids, they would like to continue to tackle. But that doesn't, again, that doesn't work for everybody. Like Coach Wolfgram was saying, we need to make sure that we are doing everything possible to get kids involved at whatever point they're at. Not every kid is ready to tackle another kid, the contact piece. Not every kid is ready at third grade or fifth grade or even seventh grade. Not every kid's ready for that. So the more we can do to increase our options for kids to get them involved, that's what we want to do. And so that's the intriguing piece about flag. Again, kids that play flag, are they going to be hesitant to tackle at high school level? Maybe yes, maybe no. It's all what that kid is ready to do mentally, physically, emotionally. That's going to determine it a lot more than whether or not a kid's tackling at third and fourth grade. So, the numbers is the key. If we can attract 10 more kids a year by having a flag team, it's worth doing. And so that's kind of my feelings on flag right now.
Coach White?
So, yeah, I mean, I'm definitely a big fan of flag football. One good thing about doing flag football through the YMCA is I get to track the numbers. And so for the last 3 years, we've stayed consistent with our numbers from flag to the start of third and fourth grade tackle football. Up here in the Great North, I think that the moms are less of a concern. In fact, I think I'm a little bit more on the other end. Even with my own life, I mean, I think that if there's an opportunity for us to move towards flag in the third and fourth grade, I think that it would be me. It would be my push more than anybody else's. So we've been able to stay consistent with our numbers from flag football to that. I alluded to it the other night where we were looking for, 10, 8 to 12 kids per class. And we've been able to maintain that over the last 3 to 4 years in the youth levels. So the third and fourth grade are into the fifth and sixth grade are maintaining those numbers from flag. But I think that the flag foundation is the key component to the whole thing. So if we need to, over the course of time, if we see those numbers start to dip a little bit, then we will certainly move to a longer period of time with flag football. So I'm in agreement there.
And how about in Bangor, Dan? What's it look like down up there?
Well, I'd say a couple of things. First, similarly to some other programs, Bangor, we tackle 3, 4, 5, 6 in the Southern Maine Youth Football League. We do have a K-2 flag league, and then we give kids the option to play flag essentially 2 through 5 if you want to make that choice. We also allow kids who play in the tackle league to compete in the flag league on Sundays. So some of them do both. A group of my son and a group of his buddies go to, they practice all week in tackle, and then they play a Saturday game usually. And then on Sundays, they went over and competed with the flag kids as well to try to bring them all together in kind of one umbrella. So that's how it works in Bangor. I would say a couple of things about flag football in general. At a high school where we got a lot of ninth graders or even upperclassmen that had never played football before, I started to rack my brain about why these kids hadn't played. Football, we all know the great positives about football. The camaraderie, the life lessons, doing things you didn't think you could do, all the great things that football teaches us. And I started to wonder, well, why aren't these kids playing? And Coach Wolfgram hit on both. There's either a parental component or kids are afraid to be physical. And to me, if flag football is going to erase those barriers or at least limit how many kids are stuck behind them, then I think it's a great opportunity. The other thing I would say is that from a sports medicine angle, I don't know if they'll ever be able to mandate it or legislate it, but some of these changes are definitely coming, like Burke said, through USA Football and some of the information that we've gotten through those folks. there's a real movement towards maybe a stratified approach to football where you might start with flag football, then work your way into flag football with uppers, but maybe on a smaller field, and then work your way towards the middle school level where maybe in your eighth grade year now you're in full pads on a full-size field. And by tiering that experience, not only do you allow those kids to get used to, if you will, the competition and the contact, but you keep them involved. One of the biggest things I find in this area is if a kid plays, I hear this all the time. Oh yeah, I played in middle school and I didn't really like it. Or I played in third grade and then I stopped because I got hit in the head. I feel like when we lose our kids to another sport, it's much harder to get them back. And so if flag football can keep those kids involved until we can sink our hooks into them and bring them into our programs, I think we're going to be much better off.
Yeah, I think for, you know, for me, I'm just looking at what Aaron wrote here. They're piloting a tackle transition and exploration program at SP this fall. We've had it set up for a while where when you get to second grade, you can kind of choose to do tackle or flag. And even for a while we had, they would do flag to start the year. And then they would kind of at the end of the year, do a couple weeks where they would put on pads and do that. And the last couple of years, you know, I've tried to work with the youth directors on transitioning to more of the, I think what Coach called the multiple points of entry, where kids just have more choice about when they can choose to do tackle football. So like last year we upped it to third graders, and this year we would like to up it to fourth graders and just kind of continue that path, I think, all the way through grade school. So, you know, for once a kid hits third grade, from third to sixth grade, they can kind of decide when they're ready to do that. And their parents can make that decision, and they have a little bit more ownership of it. You know, to be quite honest, our parents, a lot of our parents fight it. I think, you know, to what Danny speaks to, I'm probably going to be the one that has to push it more because there's so many parents that don't want to be the, you know, if something does get put down, they don't want to be the class of, oh, my kid couldn't play tackle when he was in third grade, which I don't think is the best mentality. But that mentality is certainly out there, and it's a little bit of a struggle to get those guys to see the overall picture of, you know, what we're looking for is numbers. And anything that would help our numbers would be good. And what I'm looking for is for kids to enjoy the experience. And, you know, my oldest kid, you know, I mean, he was playing tackle football, you know, at the youngest age you could possibly play it. And same for my middle child. And, you know, it was fine for them. They were smaller, but, you know, they were not shy on contact probably. And, you know, playing quarterback, there's probably not as much, you know, tackling and things like that that they had to do. But my youngest son plays, and he's kind of small. And, you know, as a third grader, he, you know, he struggled with the contact piece of it. He didn't really enjoy it. And it really opened my eyes to see that, you know, not everybody's wired the same. And, you know, he thought, you know, long and hard about playing football going into his fourth grade year and decided to play and had a great year, and it went well, but it almost went the other way. And that's a, you know, a kid who's growing up in a football house. So, you know, I think it's important that we take a look at it. And I like the idea of the multiple points of entry. The other thing that came up in the initial go round was eight man. And so John and Bob, I'd like to ask you two specifically, because you guys are going to be, you know, coaching eight-man football this high school season. You know, would you prefer to see the middle school kids? If you have a high school eighth grade program, would you prefer to see the middle school and youth kids playing eight-man? Does it matter to you? You know, what are some thoughts on that? Maybe, John, you could start there.
First of all, Mike, I just took some notes when everybody was talking. I just jotted down a few things. I want to reflect on those real quickly.
Yeah, go ahead.
First thing I want to mention is flag football is fun. It's pure fun. You know, if you go to a flag football jamboree or tournament, whatever, I have three grandsons who play flag football. And I go every Sunday, and there's a lot of energy. There's a lot of passion. The kids have fun doing it. Not that the contact football isn't fun, but flag football is actually pure fun. Second thing I want to mention, reflecting on what Dan said, states have actually begun to mandate when contact football can start. There is something in the California legislature right now. There's something in the Massachusetts legislature. Excuse me, if they ever deal with a COVID-19 situation there. They got legislation that's going to mandate when contact football can start. So it's we as coaches who want to do this. We don't want legislators doing that. Next thing I want to mention, Aaron talked about transition activities. There are several ways to transition into contact now. There's something called rookie tackle. There's something that they call tackle bar. There's another third thing that I can't remember what it was. But there's transition activities that transition from flag football into contact football. And I think the biggest thing is teaching tackling. That's the biggest thing. I think we can begin to teach tackling while kids are still playing flag football, teaching kids how to balance up and break down, for instance, teaching the contact fit and things like that. We don't have to wait till they start contact football. We can actually integrate some of this stuff in earlier and teach some of those things. So there's ways to transition. Okay, to answer your question about eight-man football, did you say, Mike, is it flag or contact, or what did you say?
Would you prefer, you know, as the high school coach, would you prefer that your middle school and youth programs be eight-man programs?
Doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter.
No, you can make that transition. I think if you played 11-man, the kids came in, the differences aren't that stark. You know, you could do it. It wouldn't matter.
Bob, how about you?
Well, we're dealing with that right now. You know, the last 3 or 4 years, we've had a group of kids come through that are pretty talented, pretty committed. You know, they've come through our youth program. They've been very successful. A few years ago, we had to postpone our middle school season because we had 13 kids. It just wasn't safe for them to continue. But this group has come through the middle school. They've done very well last year. So we're dealing with it right now. And you know, our situation is, you know, we made a decision to go eight man. Be honest with you, I don't see us going backwards on that decision. So we had the conversation the other day about what we're going to be doing with our middle school program. Originally it was going to be 11 man. But no, our indication is that we're going to be going eight man with our middle school program as well. I mean, you know, you'd like to have things lined up from top to bottom. You know, we've kind of been all over the place the last several years. You know, having had our high school season, we made the decision not to play varsity football, and that was made, you know, there's no question that was the best decision for us to make at the time. We certainly didn't want to create any sanctions from the MPA. So, but, you know, our numbers are solid. You know, the trick is now for us is to, that's why I'm taking it all in. Trick now for Orono is to make sure that we keep our numbers up and get more kids involved at the younger level. So flag, eight man, you know, we'll see how it goes.
Awesome, Coach. Perk, I want to go to you next and with a different question. I want to ask you a little bit about, because I know you're involved pretty heavily in the kind of the admin part. Do you have a minimum number of plays that each kid has to play in a game? And what are some other things that you might have in there that you do with coaches to encourage kids to kind of keep playing?
And we actually have this in a contract, and sadly we had to create a contract for these coaches, and it's 2 pages. I mean, there's crazy stuff in there from you can't face mask, you can't swear and yell at a kid, which all things seem common to us. Sadly, every year there's like, oh, we have to put this issue in there because common sense coaching these kids. So every year we have something to add to this. And last year, the big issue playing. We had a guy who felt that he wanted 11 on each side and he wouldn't rotate kids. So we had to put in every kid's got to play every quarter. And everybody should be playing equal time. And we don't care about wins. We just want every one. And we also had to create a rule that you couldn't, on game day, make a kid play a position he hasn't practiced. Because the coach here, he had a play corner all week. Well, he put him at nose guard. And then yelled at him for not doing his job. Of course, the kid had no idea. He never played that. So those are all issues that we've tried to change our contract and our rules a little bit to educate those guys, like, this is why this doesn't make sense. This is why this would be bad for a kid and why a kid would get frustrated and quit the game. So those are all some things that we've had to really hone in on.
Danny, how about you guys over at Foxcroft?
So we don't have anything in terms of like minimum plays, but like I mentioned before, I've got another one of my assistants from the high school level that coaches with me in the third and fourth grade, and there's two of them at the fifth and sixth grade, and there's one at the seventh and eighth grade. Certainly at the third and fourth grade, we're running kids through all the time. I mean, it's equal play at the third and fourth grade level, so there's really no issue there. Fifth and sixth, it does get a little bit more competitive because they are running a little bit more of what we do or what we're trying to do at the high school level, and it does separate a little bit competitively at the fifth and sixth grade level, at least up here. I think being a presence on the sideline helps, but the fact that I've got a couple of coaches that are on the high school staff that are on the sideline keep things in perspective for the one or two guys that help out on game day that get a little carried away. And then in the seventh and eighth grade, I think we're really turning into competition and, you know, guys separating themselves. And we're not in a situation where we've got 20 kids on the sidelines. So, you know, it's a little bit different in that respect. So, that's where we're at.
Dan O'Connell, how about you guys in Bangor?
So we joined the Southern Maine Youth Football League this year and played. Previously, we had been an in-house entity. We had a great experience with Coop's program a couple years ago, and they came up to play a game. Certainly, we went into the SMYFL because we weren't getting what we thought was a good experience in the league we were in. Certainly not the experience we have with Bonnie Eagle. That was great, but that was outside of our league. We joined the SMYFL, and although there's no rule on how many plays, et cetera, we took it upon ourselves to divide our kids in half. We tried to divide them evenly in a red and a white group so that in each game, and in the SMYFL, you play a third grade game, a fourth grade game, a fifth grade game, and a sixth grade game on any given weekend. And so we tried to divide those groups in half so that one kid wouldn't play the whole game. Essentially, he would play offense one half on the red team, and then he would play defense in the second half with that same group. So that's how we got all of the kids to play in each game.
Yeah, in turn, Coop, I'm going to come to you after I talk for a minute. I'm going to ask you about the in-house deal because I know you do that, and I think Mark Soren does that over at Oxford Hills as well. But I'll speak to what we do at Levitt. A couple things. One is that we have a kind of a number that's a cap for a roster size. So once we get to a certain number, we have to divide into a second team, or even at another number, we have to divide it into a third team. So we're really trying not to start the year with any more than 18 to 20 kids on a team. If you go way back to, I think when my son was in fourth grade, you know, we didn't have that in there, and there was one team with, you know, we kept taking kids after the season ended. We ended up with, you know, like 36 kids on one team, and it was impossible to deal with. So we kind of put that rule in, and that's made it better. In terms of the coaches being able to manage the playing time, it's easier for them. We do have a minimum number of plays that they're required to play in a game. Off the top of my head, I can't remember what it is, but it may even be written in as a series, per half or something like that. But I would say that the teams that I've coached on, usually they want me to help with the offense, which is fine. I don't mind doing that, but I said the number one thing I'd like to help with is substitutions, because I want to make sure that every kid plays. And you know, I think there's ways to, you know, be competitive depending on the level you're at, and still get kids in the game and make everybody feel important. And I think, you know, that's what kids are looking for. They want to feel like they're part of the team and that they're making a significant contribution. And, you know, this year on my son's third and fourth grade team, you know, we probably had, I think we finished the year with like 21 kids, because we took on a couple after the year started. But I bet of those 21 kids, I bet 14 or 15 of them got to carry the ball over the course of the year. Maybe even a couple more. So, you know, I think doing some things like that, and I think, you know, to speak to Perk's point, you got to have a few provisions in there, because you are going to have some coaches that, you know, don't have the right priorities, I think sometimes. So I think it's helpful. Coop, you want to talk about just how you guys do it with the, you know, keeping everything in-house?
Yeah, sure. So for our third and fourth grade league and our fifth and sixth grade league, we take all our kids, we divide up into equal number teams. Most recently, we've had three teams at the third and fourth grade level, three teams at the fifth and sixth grade level. We've had years when there's been four teams, but we're going to divide up whatever, you know, if we have 50 kids, we're going to divide up by three, put them on teams, try as best we can to make them equal teams. That is a tough, very tough thing to do, but we're going to try to make them as equal as possible. And then we're just going to play each other. And so our youth program plays on Sunday mornings. So in about a 2-hour time frame, we'll each team at each age group, so say we're fifth and sixth grade, so each fifth and sixth grade team will play at one half against one team, one half against another team. And so thereby getting a full game on a Sunday morning. And so this is what I did when I first came to Bonnie Eagle. My feeling is we wanted as many kids playing. So we don't run into the same issues playing time-wise. We do not have any contracts or anything like that that says a kid's got to play X amount of plays. Fortunately, when you do it kind of how, like how we do it, the coaches on one team, they got their team has green jerseys on, it says Scots. Coaches on the other team, they got black jerseys on, it says Scots. They switch and play the third team, it might be a silver jersey, it says Scots. So I think that right there lessens the desire for coach to try to win rather than develop players. It still happens. We still have to worry about it at Bonnie Eagle. It's a constant theme of mine. Like they have sponsors, business sponsors. Those coaches will refer to their teams by the business sponsors. I never call them that. It's the green team or the black team or the gray team. I keep telling coaches, I don't care who wins. I think that alleviates a little bit of the pressure on, you know, the playing time thing where you're trying to play the same kids because you want to win. That is, it's really hard to take any coach at any level and say, don't worry about winning. If you put yourselves in that same situation, it's going to be difficult, even with best intentions. So it's got to be a constant thing. I think with our situation, it works out better. As far as kids, we want to develop as many quarterbacks as we can develop. We want to develop as many running backs as we can develop. Those are the two positions that you need kids. You need kids in there. You need them playing. So I don't want to have a sixth grade team that plays one quarterback and that's pretty much it. I want three sixth graders playing quarterbacks. I want three fifth graders playing quarterbacks. So every class that comes through has multiple kids that have taken a snap, multiple kids that have carried the ball. That's what we're trying to do with our deal. When we get to seventh and eighth grade, now we're playing more as a Bonnie Eagle team in the Smithville League that we have down here for middle school. But as far as our how we do things, it's all in-house, round robin with our own kids.
Awesome, Adam. Welcome to the discussion. Good to see you. Coach O'Connell gave us a little bit of your background kind of before we started. But could you just talk briefly about your role with U football right now and what you're doing?
Sure, happy to. Thanks for having me on, and sorry to be late. I'm on a board for a veterans group, and we had a meeting at the exact same time. But I've been coaching youth football for a few years. I have two sons, one's 10 and one's 8. Started coaching about 3 years ago in the third and fourth grade level. With my older son, moved up to the fourth and fifth grade level. And next year I'm going to jump back down to the third and fourth grade level as my youngest son's going to be playing. It's been a really good experience. I mean, that we're in Sanford Schools, the Smithel League. It's really competitive in a good way, meaning lots of parity in the league. There aren't a lot of blowouts, which I think is nice. Just some lessons learned that I've had that I'll quickly pass along, and that's the importance, I think, of getting a really good like-minded coaching staff early. In particular, football, unfortunately, more than most sports, you tend to get some of these. It attracts some people that want to coach that think yelling is sort of the way to be a coach, or screaming or things like that, and they focus more on the emotional rather than at this level the kids really need a basic understanding on how to do stances appropriately, about how to do some real basic level understanding and love for the sport and building the team. Also being very open and honest and talking with the parents. Some of the parents in particular get a little nervous about their kids playing football and concerned of some of the hazards with that. So I think you really need to reaffirm for them that their kids are in good hands, and that you're very cautious about when introducing contact and learning the appropriate way to do that. And lastly, and I think Kevin was talking about this when I chimed in, the huge importance of connecting with your varsity staff, talking to those coaches, having them come down and perhaps some varsity players to talk to the kids. These are the ones that they look up to and aspire to become, and you can sort of set that tone. And what we have done, we went and met with Mike Fallon, the Sanford varsity coach, early on, and asked him, you know, what do you want your kids at this level learning? What are some basic sets of plays, some basic things to introduce? Because sometimes, you know, you get some of these coaches, or I do it myself, coming in and thinking I'm going to set up my own offensive or defensive scheme, and it's not helpful really for the varsity that way if you're going to do it. And I think you can really see the difference in some of the varsity programs that have instituted that at the lower level, where their kids are getting up to the junior high and high school and varsity level, and these kids have been in the system for a number of years. They understand it. So it allows the coaches, you know, when they get up to the varsity level, to really add some flavor and some dimension to the offense and the defense, because the kids already understand the basics of it. So those are just some of the experiences I've had. I've really enjoyed it. Really enjoyed it.
Awesome. Appreciate it. Danny White, I'm going to come over to you next and just talk a little bit about, since you're right there doing it. And I know, because I did it last year too, at the third and fourth grade level, just in terms of the structure of practice, and you know, how you're running a practice with those guys to make sure, one, that everything's safe, and two, that, you know, kids are having a good experience, and three, that they're learning. What would you suggest for some good tips in terms of running a youth practice?
Yeah, so we practice for an hour and a half, and we spend an hour blocking and tackling. I mean, and it's redundant. But you find different drills to keep the kids engaged and keep them excited. And you know, keep the lines down. So find, you know, as many volunteers and dads as you can find to, you know, fulfill your practice so that you can keep the kids rolling through. But we spend a half an hour on tackling, half an hour on blocking, and then we work for a half an hour on offense and defense. More times than not, we're working more on offense because we're just trying to get the plays in. You know, we try every practice to do some shotgun stuff, but at the third and fourth grade level, we're mostly under center because we can't get the snap down. But the heavy focus, as I'm sure it is with most of you, is blocking and tackling. I mean, without proper instruction, without proper practice, doing that, then we're wasting our time come Saturday or Sunday whenever we're playing, because the kids don't know what they're doing and they get hurt. So for the last two or three years, we've been fortunate in that regard, and we've been able to keep kids healthy. So so that's the primary focus.
Perk, how about you?
Yeah, Danny hit on a lot of great points, tackling and blocking. The other thing we really focus on is time, as far as nothing more to keep every drill no more than 15 minutes. If we can keep them to 10, that's our goal, so that we're switching up and going to something else. And another big thing with doing that is to really make sure we have a rule that we meet before, the coaches meet before and after practice, just to reiterate certain things. Because like so many have said, you'll have guys that come in there and all of a sudden you get kids 20 yards apart going full speed at each other. And then one of those kids doesn't come back. So we've tried to show those guys ways to tackle without kids getting hurt. We've bought them the big pads they can land on, how to go slow and all these things, to really teach them how to safely do it, to build confidence and to slow it down so you can really coach up a kid on what is correct and what isn't. But Danny's point of doing things repetitively are so important at that level, and not getting ahead of yourself and worrying about scheme or any of that. Just the fundamentals, but making sure that you're switching it up every 10, 15 minutes to keep them engaged.
Coach Wolfgram, I would say that you're probably well known for running some pretty efficient practices. So what do you have for some thoughts on, just practice structure and things that you would emphasize coaching at the youth and middle school level?
Okay. Before I start talking about practice structure, the first thing I want to mention is the biggest problem with youth football contact-wise is the safety factor. That's the biggest problem. The second biggest problem is retention of coaches. You know, retaining coaches who have the right mindset, basically, who are teachers and not yellers and screamers. And the thing about football is kids will coach when their son is playing. And then obviously when the kid gets older, they move on to the next level. So there's kind of like what I call a carousel of coaches. That becomes a real problem because you've got to reteach everybody over again. And excuse me, the instruction for tackling is different than any other instruction. It's different than anything else. And it really requires a coach who understands how to do things, and that safety is the first and foremost thing. In terms of practice organization, I would reiterate what everybody else has said. Keep things short. Keep your mods to 10 minutes, all right? Make them fun. Make them high energy. Tackling-wise, I would make sure that everything was close order and no more than 5 yards apart. I would start with the fit position, working from there, basically. I think the most important thing we can teach kids to tackle is the balance up position, or what I call the breakdown position. That's the most important thing. If kids can break down and make close order contact, what we call six-inch explosion, the chances for safety are much, much more. It's when kids go in there flying like a missile, that's when you have problems. And I think the head coaches should be very much involved in teaching their youth coaches how to tackle, how to instruct tackle. That's very, very important. And so I would make it fun. I would keep the sessions, the mods short order, okay? And, just high energy stuff that the kids are having fun at.
Awesome. Coop, I'll kind of segue. That's a good segue. I'll go over to you for the next one. In terms of working with your youth coaches on teaching tackling, how are you coaching those guys up to in turn coach it to the kids?
Yeah, so it's hard. It is hard. It's really like Coach Wolfgang was just saying, the carousel of coaches. It's a real thing. It's very difficult to not have that at the youth level. Speaking from myself as a parent coach, especially in the other two sports, like I'm not staying down to coach Little League anymore that my kids are aging out of Little League. You know, I'm not going to coach sixth grade basketball after this year, because my kids aren't going to be sixth graders anymore. So I understand that as a parent, that you're going to progress with your kids, and when your kids get old enough, then you're going to stop coaching and you're going to go follow their game. So that's it's hard to not have that happen. So that means to teach something like tackling, it's got to be a constant, ongoing thing. And so the problem is with new guys coming, how much effect do you have on them as a head coach? Like, we think would be a lot, but it doesn't necessarily always work out that way. If I do a instruction teaching for our youth coaches, that's one time that this youth coach has heard me, and he probably learned tackling growing up and then playing in high school, doing it over and over again for a coach, and has listened to that coach and a number of coaches for a lot longer than he's listened to me. And so it has to be an ongoing thing. At Bonnie, what works best for us is we have a person, and it doesn't always happen like this because we don't always have a person that can fit this bill, but it works best for us when we have a person that is not one of our youth coaches that can be at a practice and oversee how practice is going. And if things aren't being instructed right, especially tackling, then that person can get involved. That person can really know what I want to accomplish and then see the coach right there. I've been fortunate where I've been able to do that the last couple of years because, again, my kids were playing. But as a high school head coach, you can't be there all the time. But you've got to be there as much as possible. But you really need someone else that can view a practice, be there when all the fifth and sixth grade kids are practicing, or all the third and fourth grade kids are practicing in our system, and watch practice. And if there's a problem, and again, most of the problems are going to come up to me with two things: teaching tackling and teaching offensive line play. So the offensive line play is usually neglected. Tackling won't be neglected because coaches are going to want to do that, but are they going to instruct it the right way? And are they going to do it in a safe way? That's not a given. It's a constant thing that you can, as a head high school coach, can just never let go. It's got to be every year. It's got to be constant. I've got to meet with youth coaches at the beginning of the year. I've got to try to get down to a practice during the year. I've got to be there and see the tackling instruction. I've got to have someone that's my eyes during a practice to make sure things are done the right way.
Dan O'Connell, do you know, we've talked a little bit about this at other times. Do you think there's some merit to having some sort of tackling certification or training that all youth coaches have to go through?
Well, I certainly think that we need some system to hold those youth coaches accountable. I don't know that we'll ever, as a group of head coaches, agree on the exact same technique across the board and be able to necessarily pick one entity to teach us how to tackle. But I do believe that one of the ways that we can do some of the things that Coach Wolfgram and Coach Cooper are talking about is to come up with a way to hold them accountable and be certified in some capacity, whether the Maine Football Coaches Association puts a subcommittee together and we write that program, or we use USA Football or Atavist or you know, a number of different people who are out there, remains to be seen. But I do feel strongly that if you're going to be someone who's going to be in charge of a drill with tackling, not necessarily a volunteer all the time, and I know in certain places, or probably in all places, it's hard to get numbers of coaches, just like it's hard to get numbers of kids. But if you're going to be in charge of contact in the name of tackling, in this case, with a group of young student athletes, I really feel like there should be some certification that says somebody educated you on this in some way. There will be guys that don't need it, that have done it a million times, and thankfully we'll have them working with our kids. But the vast majority of youth coaches, in my estimation and my observation, need it. And so whatever we can do to move in that direction, I think is key.
Awesome. Coach Sinclair, Coach Koop talked about the development of the O-line play is another thing that maybe goes a little overlooked. I know, you know, one of the struggles for kids is that not many of them early on want to be linemen. And then probably number two, that there's probably not a lot of coaches out there qualified to teach good line play. So, what would be some recommendations or some things that you've done in your programs in the past to try to develop linemen at younger levels?
Well, in our situation, it's been difficult. I think the last few years. I mean, last year the superintendent and our AD asked me to coach both the high school and the middle school teams, and I don't know if anybody in the States ever been asked to carry that kind of a burden before. But we did it. I was fortunate enough to have some great help with some of the coaches who had come through our youth program and help from some of the varsity kids. But it was very, very difficult. And also in our youth program last year, we could only muster, after that great group of kids had come through two classes in a row where we had, 16 kids in each group, seventh and eighth grade. Last year, we could muster six kids in our youth program. So it's constant work. So for me, I've been very hands-on. I mean, it's been, I'm down there with the kids, making everybody a lineman, getting them into a stance, taking them through drills. You know, we don't have the luxury of doing stuff that would put kids in jeopardy, and we wouldn't do it anyway. I think selling the kids on the fact that as an offensive lineman, you're special, and it's a part of the game that even though it may not appear to be the most glamorous part of the game, it's a very necessary part of the game. We talk to our kids a lot about how special they are in terms of learning how to recognize different things. At the middle school, you'll find this funny, at the middle school level the last couple of years, at the high school level for years, Dan can attest to this, we would change blocking assignments at the line of scrimmage based upon what kind of a front we would see for some of our stuff. We haven't been noted to be a real innovative offensive system, but it's worked for us. We were able to do that same kind of thing in the middle school level last year, where kids can come out, recognize an outer even front, make some line calls, and change the blocking assignments at the line of scrimmage. We even began to do that with that other group that we had come through for the last couple of years, where they were doing it. We could not do that at the high school level the last two or three years. Honest to God, we couldn't do it. So we really try to sell our kids on the fact that cognitively, you've got to be a smart player. You've got to learn a lot about football. It may not appear to be the most glamorous thing. And once again, hearing the way your practices are structured, I think ours are structured the same way. No long lines, keep things moving, change your drill up quickly, and that kind of stuff. But that's what we do. We try to really accentuate the importance of being an offensive lineman at a young age.
Adam, you kind of alluded to the need for a good relationship between the high school coach and the people in the youth program, and also, kind of talked about how the kids come down and help out a little bit from the high school with the youth players as well. What are some good ways to find those opportunities and to make sure that happens between the youth program and the high school program from your perspective, being at the youth level?
So the best way is to do it early. These varsity coaches have busy schedules and they've got a lot on their mind. So I would say waiting till the season has started is too late, and it's not really fair for them. What helped us, a couple things, because I'm in year four now, since I've been doing it, and we've had some lessons learned applied. The first is trying to increase our numbers. We found our numbers to be kind of small early on, like Coach Sinclair's talking about. We really started working to get kids that had been playing to, hey, talk to your friends or reach out. And I would give some parents calls on on kids that my son would say, boy, we play out in the playground and, you know, he's a great receiver, or this kid would be a, you know, great player, loves to play. So I would talk to some of their parents, and some of the other coaches would do that. We would have these early discussions. We and we're pleased this year that the only program in Smithel and one other league, I'm not sure what the other one was, but we saw the spreadsheet, we were second only to Saco in numbers of kids that had signed up to play. We were really, really impressed with that and pleased because we did that work in the off season to do it. The other thing was reaching out in the spring, really, to the varsity coach and getting that playbook out and talking to Coach Fallon and asking him the, you know, what are the 10 plays you'd like to see us do well on offense? And then, you know, working a couple fun plays for the kids, you know, the reverse and you know, things like that, maybe a screen pass here and there or something to kind of mix it up so it'll be fun for him too. So we started with Coach Fallon early. We had him on opening day, opening practice. We did some of these sort of fun assessment drills where we would, you know, time the kids in a 40. We would do a shuttle run. We would do some things where we could sort of mark some improvement for him and have Coach Fallon give a speech. And he had the captains of the team down there. And, you know, when you're in fourth and fifth grade, these are the kids you look up to. And if you're fortunate enough to have captains on your varsity team that are good role models and good kids, that's important too. Having them give that talk to, you know, everything from do well in school and, you know, you guys are building a team effort, all of those types of things. We would start that early. And then we would have the coach come down and check with Coach Fallon and when he could bring down his seniors, for example, and have them run a practice where we did what we called Spartan time, where we'd divide up in different stations. We had about 8 different stations all run by one of the seniors in sort of a helmet and shoulder pads type thing where we would do, you know, kind of fun drills for the kids and have them bond with the upperclassmen. So when they would go to the varsity games later in the week, we noticed a lot more of our kids were going to the varsity games because they felt like they knew the older kids. You know, they'd be kind of proud to wear that jersey, show there and show some school pride. So so those were some of the things that we did. And I think it's paid off so that it's built much more of a sense of building some tradition. I'll end with this. I think one of the biggest challenges we have, and I get a sense because I saw Dan's post that I missed when he sent that out to everyone on the group chat, is kind of this year-round sports thing that's going on with all these other sports. We you know, it's not something I'm a real fan of, a lot of these travel leagues and, you know, this year-round limiting kids to one sport. That's been a challenge for us because football isn't a year-round sport. It shouldn't be, I think. And getting some of these kids that want to play fall baseball or fall basketball to play, that's been a challenge for us. And we've found that the most successful way we can address that is talking to the kids and having the kids on that are on our team talk to those kids, because so much at that age group is about being with your friends, kind of bonding with them. And if all your buddies are playing and it's the fun thing to do, then it makes you more inclined to do it. We've had some success with it, and we've had some other kids that we wished would play, but they're, you know, they're sports baseball and they're fourth grade. You know, I don't know. It's kind of insane what's going on, I think, but that's some of the experiences we've had with it.
Yeah, I'll speak to that point a little bit as well. I feel like we do a pretty good job in our program, and I've mentioned this on a couple of other talks as well, but I think you make a good point that earlier is better. You know, it certainly, as the season rolls on, it's much harder for the high school coaches and kids to budget their time to be able to go down and work with, you know, with all of the groups. I probably, once the year starts, I probably tried to work with my middle school group as much as any of them. Because they're the closest in terms of me getting them. And, you know, once their season starts, I think their coaches appreciate the help. And it's not just me, it's other guys on my staff too. But we'll go down and you know, hey, here's a couple new DN drills that you can use with the defensive ends because you've been doing the same ones for, you know, 4 weeks now, which is good. It's repetitive, but, you know, here's something you can do to spice it up. Or, you know, maybe the line struggled, you know, blocking a, you know, a 4-4 the last week. So we send the line coach down and he'll do that. But in terms of before the season, you know, for one, if you guys haven't seen John Morin's presentation, it was excellent and is up on the YouTube page and you should check it out. He had a whole thing of kind of coordinating youth and high school program together. So if you haven't, make sure you check that one out. It's great stuff. I've got some Zoom clinics going with my youth and middle school coaches next week. And I think using this technology might help, because I find one of the hardest things is getting everybody in the room at the same time. Because in the spring, those same dads that are going to coach football for you in the fall are probably coaching baseball, or track or whatever it may be. But they're busy. So, you know, it's hard to get everybody there at once. So I know one objective for me moving forward is to see if we can do some of this virtually and you know, have some sessions where we get the coaches on and I present on a topic or we have a good roundtable discussion about playing time and practice structure and things like that. I think, you know, that would be something great moving forward. I always try to meet with the coaches in the summer and I meet with the director and usually the head coaches of the middle school and the fifth and sixth grade teams in the spring just to kind of get a feel for what they're thinking, what our numbers look like. You know, who's coming back from, you know, from fifth into sixth and such and things like that. And just to kind of start the, you know, the conversation and that relationship. But then in the summer, at the end of the summer, we end every summer with what we call the Hornet Pride Camp. It's usually either the last week in July, right before the hands off, or sometimes the next to last week, just, you know, kind of depending on where it falls on the calendar. But we have every kid in our program from, you know, second grade to 12th grade on the field all at the same time. And we overlap the times so that, you know, we're not there for, you know, 9 hours. But, you know, we bring out all the grade school kids at about 4:30, quarter five. We get them, you know, make sure their equipment's right. You know, all the high school players are there. I mean, I don't have to say anymore at this point, like, you guys have to be there. Like, they know because they were all there. You know, when they went to camp, they saw all the high school kids there. So the kids come in, they get to talk to the high school kids, you know, toss the ball around, have a little bit of fun. You know, we introduce all the high school kids on the first day, you know, have them introduce themselves and say who they are, what position they play, what year they are, you know, what number they are, stuff like that. And then in the grade school session, which is second to sixth, the high school kids lead the drills. So, you know, we'll have the linemen, you know, we'll do an offensive, you know, a half an hour block of offense, and our offensive linemen will be, you know, down there, and there'll be a coach down there, but they're usually not doing much other than organizing. But the kids are teaching those kids how to be linemen and showing them the basic drills that, you know, they were taught when they were that age, and some that we still do, you know, now. And you know, in terms of developing kids who want to be linemen, we've had a pretty good run on that. And I think that's a big piece. Like, those guys, you know, if we're lucky enough to have a camp this summer, they'll get to see, you know, Tommy Casey. It'll be Tommy Casey teaching them how to do lineman drills, not our line coach necessarily. And it'll be, you know, Wyatt Hathaway showing quarterbacks how to throw a football. So that's been a big staple of what we've done in terms of getting the kids involved. And, you know, the one thing I love about our program is that all the kids know each other. From, doesn't matter what grade they're in, whether it's middle school, youth, or high school. There's interaction between all of them. And then as we kind of transition, you know, to the middle school session, you know, we like to use our high school coaches in coordination with the middle school coaches. So the middle school coaches are shadowing the high school players around, and we're kind of running the practice. We've got the youth coaches kind of take over the end of the youth portion and do some fun things with those guys. And then the high school coaches are running a middle school practice for a week. And the middle school coaches are following them around with the positions that they're going to coach and the drills that they're going to instruct. And they're seeing it, you know, more than once, because we're repeating those drills throughout the week. So we're trying to coach our coaches during that time. And we're also trying to, you know, start a foundation of instruction with our middle school players so that they have a good base and, you know, they're hearing it the way that we want it taught. And then, you know, we kind of release the high school guys to go inside and change up. And then we bring them out and they finish the night. And a lot of kids stick around and watch us practice. A lot of parents stick around and watch us practice. And, you know, it's really been a good thing. Our numbers for that camp have been unbelievable. And it's, you know, I did it the very first year, and I didn't have a lot of kids back in 02. And then the next year we probably doubled. And, you know, I bet we roll, you know, probably 80 to 100 kids out there between second and eighth grade every summer. So I would recommend to anybody something like that. I think, you know, to get your kids, coaches, all everybody on the field, a lot of buy-in, a lot of pride on it. I think it's been really good. So I had a couple other things on my list, but I bet they might come up with some questions. There's a lot of guys, you know, out there. So I'm going to let guys turn on their cameras at this point. And if guys have some questions they want to ask, and then if there's some guys on the panel that kind of have something else that they want to speak to, we can do that. So, Coach Lipp, you're on first, man. You're up.
Yeah, the one thing I struggle with big time is I don't care if, like, our 7th and 8th grade runs our offense. There's been a year or two where they've tried and it hasn't really gone well, whether that's just the shotgun snap or the plays, or how do you guys feel about that? Because I think most people I hear – are like kind of adamant that they run it at least in 7th and 8th grade, ideally in 5th and 6th, and, you know, maybe in 1st. So, like, I've tried a little bit. I know my 5th and 6th grade coaches will never change. I don't know as though I care, but should I be trying to, in your opinion, you know, get the 7th and 8th grade? What are the advantages? But I think I can coach a slant to anyone by the time, you know, if they're a sophomore and they show up. Are there major advantages you've seen because you're a 7th and 8th grade? I know, Mike, you certainly have advocated for that. They know jet sweep and these 4 or 5 base runs. Anybody have a feeling on that, or adamant one way or another? Because I'm really planning to make some changes this offseason. I'm curious.
But I'll just start with what I spoke to before about some middle school coaches not being in there anymore is almost specifically that. Like, they were not willing to do anything that we did at the high school. Like, they wanted to run the power eye and beat the snot out of each other all practice.
But do you have the ability to fire them? Because I can't get rid of my guys. They're people, so I can't. I don't really
I don't have the ability per se, but I would say I have the ear of the athletic director at the middle school, and he was willing to pull the trigger on it, and you know, we were able to make that happen. But our middle school offense, you know, probably looks exactly the same as what our freshmen run, you know, with the, you know, but just probably a little dialed down from that, and you know, in 3rd and 4th, I'm not a huge, you know, I don't really demand that anybody runs anything or anything like that. But I, you know, the team that I helped with this year that my kid was on, we ran jet sweep, counter, and inside zone, and we ran a play action off from each one of them. And those were our 6 plays. And then I let those guys pick a couple other plays that, you know, like the reverses and things that they wanted. But, you know, I found that jet sweep is one that people will buy into, because everybody in youth football wants to give it to the fastest kid and let him run around the corner. You know, like that's the foundation of youth football offense forever, probably. So, you know, and they see us run it and have some success with it, so they're willing to buy in. But I would, you know, by 5th grade, I would think, at least in terms of terminology and the verbiage that we're going to use at the basic level with how we call plays, I would want them doing it at that point and at least have a couple base plays. So, I don't know. Danny, you mentioned it a little bit in your talk. Danny White, you got anything to say there?
Yeah, so, I mean, 3rd and 4th grade, I mean, we can't get a shotgun snap. We can't get it down. So I don't think it's tremendously important as long as you're mixing different kids into the equation. But I would agree, by 5th and 6th grade, they should have a pretty good understanding of you know, what you're trying to do at the middle school level, which is what we're trying to do at the high school level. You know, like I said before, I mean, we're fortunate that we get to run youth football. So, you know, we get to kind of have a pretty good stronghold on who's coaching. But 3rd and 4th grade, no. 5th and 6th grade, more so, yes. And 7th, 8th grade, definitely.
Anybody else got something they want to chime in on there? BL, Coop, you want to go?
Yeah, I would say that I don't feel it's a necessity. You know, we're from 3rd grade all the way to 8th grade, we're going to be in the shotgun. But as far as what we call the plays, I mean, my middle school coach has a slightly different call system. Some things are similar, some things aren't similar. you know, our youth coaches will basically call plays like we would have a decade ago, but we've advanced for that. I mean, I wouldn't expect our youth coaches to call things what we call them. Our call system is our no huddle system. So, you know, it's a little bit different. I think as long as you have your youth kids doing basically what you do at the high school, like again, like we wouldn't want to be in the power eye because that's not what we do. But as long as we're in the shotgun, I don't see it being a big deal if they don't run exactly what you want to run. I think any type of coach needs to have an idea what the system is that they're running. If a coach doesn't know your system, it's really hard to expect him to be able to make any type of adjustments or coaching points, in especially during a game time situation. So, I mean, coaches got to run what they feel comfortable. For me at Bon Eagle, as long as they're in the gun, then I'm pretty fine with it.
So we're in double wing in fifth and sixth grade. That's how different we are. The guy knows it. They actually, that's of all of our youth levels, that's the one that maybe wins the most. Our seventh and eighth grade hasn't won a game in a decade. And we've tried this shotgun, but like you just said, like if they don't know it well enough to say, hey, there's nobody over the trip side, like just throw it out, like then I'm not sure how effective it's been. And I've tried to kind of meet with them, but it's really been a struggle with me. And I've just kind of defaulted to like, hey, make sure they have fun. The one thing they do is they always have fun and they all come back out, but I'm not sure they learned like anything about our offense. I don't know as though I see a big detriment to it, but as I listen to more and more of you guys, I feel like, yeah, maybe it would help if they knew a little bit more about what we're trying to do. So I appreciate your insights because I'm trying to make the change and I'm getting, you know, pushback across the board.
Maybe you just need to switch to double wing, BL. Maybe that's the problem.
Yes, I could. Tom Hines is like still in the school. Double wing. Guru.
That's right, baby. Come on.
100%.
All right. Awesome. Coach Goff, you got a question down there?
Oh, yeah. In terms of your youth programs, man, do you find any certain type of structures or rules that you have to implement into your youth league rules? For example, do you allow blitzing? I was at a youth game down in Florida, and it was a all-out blitz every single play. Here came the backers, here come the safeties, here come the corners, and it literally was almost every single play was a 2 or 3 yard loss on both sides. I just don't know how you get guys developed when you're doing stuff like that. So my question to you is, do you guys regulate certain type of aspects of football with your youth programs?
Perk and Dan O'Connell, you guys want to take that one?
Yeah, the younger leagues we're in, the younger kids, there is no blitzing. And I spent a lot of time with the middle school coaches as well, to really, you know, depending on the scheme we're in and what kind of best fits the kids they have. And Coop hit on this too. You got to know the knowledge the coach has. So it'll teach them what you want there and know what you're dealing with. So we cannot blitz all the time. It's not what we do. We want kids to understand what plays are, what they're seeing and how to be so on. So those guys in our summer sessions and our clinics in the winter, teaching that we're not just roll the dice and see what happens to the team.
Coach Goff, I would just tell you,